Hi, welcome to Actual Lol. Today I'm talking about the Mother of Dragons expansion for the Game of Thrones board game. Game of Thrones second edition board game is one of my favourite epic experiences in board gaming because it really captures the thematic feel of the TV show and the books, where you play as one of the houses in Westeros and you are trying to conquer different castles in Westeros by having fights with other houses, creating alliances, and then ultimately backstabbing people. It's a great game of negotiation. There's a lot to get into, and it really tells a story every time you play. And for me, it was one of the first games that made me really fall in love with board games. So I was super excited to try this new big expansion that adds a whole bunch of different things to this game. And I'm going to tell you a bit about them. This isn't a full review. I've played this expansion once. It's going to be a while before I can get the group together to play it a few times. So this isn't my finished opinions, but I do think that I've got a good feel of the game and I can tell you a bit about how it plays and also what I think of it so far. One of the biggest things that they've added with this expansion is the Vassal module, which allows you to take control of other houses in the game that nobody is playing in that particular session. So there are now 8 houses that you can play, and you can play an 8-player game if you want to. I don't feel like that's very common. And one of the original problems with the game was that when you played with 3, 4, or even 5 players, it wasn't as interesting because the factions that weren't being played just kind of sat there and they were neutral factions and you could just go in and have a fight with them and you just take them over with little trouble and didn't tell much of the story, and it made the dynamic of the game with smaller player counts a little bit boring. They've really changed that here because you can now control those factions as vassals. And the way it works is that the house that is furthest up on the Iron Throne track will get first pick on which vassal they want to control. So if you imagine we're playing a 5-player game and the Arryns and the Tyrells and the Starks are not being played by people in the game, the vassal houses are set up a little bit differently, and so you've got a card for each faction that would be played as a vassal. They work in a similar way. They muster just like a normal house would, but only in their home area. They will be on the map and you will have to fight them just like a normal house, but you can control them. So the person who is highest on the Iron Throne track gets to choose which house they go for first. So let's say that they pick the Starks because they're the Arryns. They're the Greyjoys. They're right next to them. So they don't want somebody else to pick the Starks because they will come and attack the Greyjoys and that'd be bad for them. So they want to control the Starks because maybe they want to move them out of the way so they can take Winterfell, for example. What they would do is they would take these 4 tokens here. And they are just generic tokens. They're the same for every vassal, and they just have symbols on to show that they are assigned to a particular house. And they would have those and place those order tokens as they would their own during the planning phase, except they're only allowed to place 2 of them. So they have to decide what exactly they would want to do with the Starks that round. So they can do a march or an attack. They can defend with 3, so really protect that vassal. They can, these 2 ones offer different options. So they can defend or muster, which is a really interesting addition to the game, because now they can bolster that house during the planning phase or the order phase. And then you've got a support with a +1 or a raid. And so when you flip that, you decide whether it's used as a raid or support. And you will just place them in 2 of the regions for the Starks, and you do it after you've placed your tokens. And then they would be revealed just like all the other tokens, and you would, as normal, take it in turns, and so the Starks would activate depending on their position on the Iron Throne track, just like normal. And you would control them, you would make the decisions for them. The other difference with the vassals is that they don't use their original house cards, they use these vassal cards, and these represent different sort of mercenary characters from the series. So you've got Varys, Cyrio Pharrell, Yanos Slynt, Beric Dondarrion, John Connington, Bronn, and they're like a deck of house cards in the sense that they vary slightly in power, and they also vary in their abilities, and they have some interesting abilities. So Bronn, for example, is got a strength of 4, so he's the most powerful house card. But after you reveal your house card, your opponent may discard 2 of their available power tokens to reduce this card's combat strength to 0. So that's interesting because it really fits Bronn. Basically, the other house can pay some power tokens, i.e. pay off Bronn, and then suddenly he's actually not really fighting for them anymore. So it's the most powerful card, but it also has the potential to be cancelled out. And then they each kind of fit the character, which, just like the house cards in the original game, just give you a little thematic feel. The way these vassal cards work is that if you're controlling a vassal, you would shuffle up the deck, so shuffle up all 7 of them, and you would get 3 to pick from, and then pick one of those. If 2 vassals are going against each other, which is entirely possible, then you would each get 3 cards each from the deck. One of the things I love about this module is that it changes the dynamic of how it plays every time, because instead of having these neutral factions that don't do anything and always feel the same, the vassals are controlled. Maybe it's controlled by me one round and then it switches to someone else another round. So maybe they're on the attack and they're coming at maybe the Arryns are coming at the Starks, but next round they're going at the Baratheons. Maybe in one game they'll survive right to the end of the game and really thrive. Maybe another game they get wiped out in the first few rounds. It really comes down to who's controlling them and what they want to get out of them. The other thing is that unless you're playing an 8-player game every time you play, the dynamic will be different because which houses are controlled by human players will be different. So if you've ever played the first game, you'll know that a lot of people think that the Lannisters are the weakest faction. And you play with 6 houses and the Lannisters are really hemmed in and they struggle to thrive. And if you play as them, you're kind of screwed because they're unlikely to win. In this one, well, first of all, you're adding in the Arryns, so that tends to balance Westeros a little bit because you've got the Arryns now in between the Baratheons and the Starks and opposite the Greyjoys and the Lannisters. So there's just even more going on. Then you've got the Targaryens coming in on the east side from Essos. So that's putting even more pressure on Martells, Baratheons and Starks and Arryns. On top of all of that, though, is that you will just be playing different factions and the balance will be different based on which factions you're playing and based on how the vassals play out. And I don't think that this game can be accused of having that power problem anymore. And that is fascinating and I think is one of the major problems that people have with the game, and it seems like they completely fixed it. The other great thing about the vassal system is that now it's an interesting game at 3 or 4 players. You could play with this entire massive map and it'll still be populated by things going on and you'll still be worried about how the factions are going to attack you and move, but it's the other players at the table that will be controlling them. The other thing it does is it makes the Iron Throne influence track even more important. So in the original game it was just about turn order and breaking ties. Now you really want to be at the top of that track because you will get first pick of the vassals. If you, say, playing 5 players and there's 3 empty factions in the game, then the first 3 will get a pick of the vassal, but the first 1 gets to decide which vassal they get. And that can be crucial because you might really want the one that is about to attack you or the one that you want to move out the way. What you should note, though, is that if you pick a faction that is right next door to you, as your vassal, you cannot attack your vassal this turn. So you've got to be careful. I found myself in a position where I really wanted to get them out of the way and the only way was actually to attack them. And that's not going to work because you can't attack them. So what you might want to do is let someone else take it as a vassal and then pay them off. Somehow help them, you know, it's part of an alliance. Make sure that they get the vassal you want and then they can just rig the cards for you. They can play the vassal card that you want them to play because you're working together. It adds so much more to all of that negotiation that the game already is amazing at. The other thing they've done to balance the board and the way the houses play is that they've given you 2 map overlays. So the Eyrie has now been changed from a castle to a stronghold, and they've put a new castle in a new region called the Vale of Arryn. Then you've also got a new sea region called the Bight. This is interesting because it allows the Starks or the Arryns to control this little sea here and jump across between where the Arryns start and where the Starks start, creating interesting attacks in this region. It also means that maybe the Baratheons can come in here through the narrow sea, whilst the Arryns are sort of staying in this sea region. So it allows for a bit more movement in the sea area as well. The other really exciting addition with this expansion is the Targaryen faction. And they come with this completely new Essos board, which you'll notice is too big for my table. And you are going to need a fairly deep table to be able to fit this on, because it goes beyond where the round tracker would be and fits in there. And the idea is it aligns with a bunch of sea areas. So it expands East Summer Sea and Shipbreaker Bay, and then it connects up. So now you've got a bunch of new sea areas in the Targaryen board, such as the Sea of Mirth and the Bay of Pentos. And so the Targaryens are going to be causing a lot of problems for the Martells and the Baratheons and the Arryns and the Starks. But they also represent some opportunities for them, because there are three castles on the Targaryen board which these factions could take over. And the reason why it might be a little bit easier to take over those castles is because the Targaryens don't actually need them to win the game. Of course, they do need them to muster, to improve their power as a faction, but they win the game in a completely different way to any other faction. They win it by finding loyalty within Westeros. And what I love about this is that it's really thematic to the story, because if you know the books and the TV series, the Targaryens have obviously been wiped out, and then they're trying to find people that are still loyal to them within Westeros and then kind of rise up from within. And this works in exactly the same way. So every round, there will be an extra card. There's a new Westeros deck, and a card will come up, and the Targaryens will be able to place a loyalty token somewhere in Westeros. So this one allows you to place a token in either Blackwater or the Boneway. So they will be taking one of their loyalty tokens and placing it in one of those places. So Blackwater is here. Then what they need to do to get this token is to be able to conquer this region. So if it's empty, they just walk in, or they would have a fight. And as long as they just step into Blackwater, they immediately get this token and they get a point. They are trying to get six of these to win the game, because they start off with 1 point, which is represented by Pentos, their home station. They can never lose those points either, so they're always increasing towards that victory, and the other factions really need to watch out for that. But what's so fascinating about their alternative win condition is that they can really ally with other houses well, because they want different things. So they could give up one of their houses, Volantis here. They could say to the Baratheons, look, I won't try at all to stop you from taking Volantis as long as you let me walk through where you are in Kingswood, and so that I can get up to the Blackwater easily. The other thing the Targaryens can do, which really helps with alliances, is that they can bid power tokens and then give them to other houses. The Targaryens are always at the end of every influence track. There's nothing they can do about that, but they still can bid power tokens in those auctions for the different influence tracks. And the reason they would do that is because they can then give them to another house when every house is revealed what they've bid. So they have real control over who has the most power. The other way these Targaryens can get these loyalty tokens is by sending in their dragons. Because as you might imagine, dragons can fly, so they can move from any spot as long as they play a march token to any other spot on the board. They can fly and attack someone. They can fly into an empty region. They can move anywhere with one march token. But they can only move on their own. And the dragons have a limited strength. They start off, just like in the TV series, weak and small. And so they would actually start off with a dragon strength of zero. So if you were to go into a fight with a dragon, they would provide no strength and they might be easy to kill potentially. But as the rounds go on, these tokens will be placed on the dragon strength track and they will get more and more powerful until right at the end of the game, they have a strength of 5. They will then become really vicious in battle and the Targaryens will become almost undefeatable at that point. It's up to the other factions to potentially try and attack these dragons whilst they're young. Maybe they could get them in a position where they could actually kill some of them. And if a dragon is killed, they can never come back on the board. Just like the other factions, when you get into combat with the Targaryens, you play a house card. And they have some interesting ones in their deck because they have some that are taken out of the game when they're played. So for example, Khal Drogo, he's got a power of 4. But on top of that, for every knight that he has in battle with him, he gets +1 strength and a sword, because of course he loves horses. But once he's used, he's done. So you save him for like the battle that you absolutely have to win. And Daenerys, she gets added 2 extra combat strength if she's in a battle with a dragon. The other significant addition to the game is the Iron Bank. So you can get loans from the Iron Bank in Braavos, and they will massively improve your powers, but then you have to pay back that loan that you've taken. So, for example, if you were to take this Sea Raiders card, you would immediately get 3 boats and 1 footman anywhere. As long as it meets supply, you can just take those units. You don't have to muster, but what you do have to do is pay the loan amount, which would be 4 power tokens. These will change in value, so as loans get taken or they will move off. And so at the start of the game, there's actually only 1 loan available for 7, and then they shift down, and so they will change in price. So if you can get one at the bargain of 1 power token, then great. But this card now goes in front of you, and for every round that's remaining in the game, you will have to pay a power token to the bank to pay off the loan. If you can't do that, then one of your units will be removed from the board, and it's removed by another player, so you don't get to choose where it comes off. So you just need to make sure that you've got enough power tokens to be able to afford it. So this one here will give you 8 power tokens and also place a crown on the board. And so these Iron Bank loans allow you to slightly adapt with the board. So you've got these new tokens that can add strongholds, power tokens, and supply barrels to the board, but what you can also do is remove them from the board. This card here, the Pyromancer, allows you to remove a castle from the board. So you would take one of these tokens, let's say I wanted to remove it here from Braavos, and I would just place this over it, and now there is no longer a castle there, which means it's no longer worth a point to win the game, and it's no longer able to muster. So it's a really powerful thing that you can do with this Pyromancer card, and it can really change the course of victory. If somebody's on their way to victory, you could maybe stop them with that. There's that barrel. This one allows you to not only add a barrel to your region, but it allows you to move up the supply track, which is obviously one of the most annoying things in the game. If that Westeros card doesn't come up, which allows you to rejig your supply track, this allows you to do it for you. So that can be a really powerful one. The way that you would go to get an Iron Bank loan is that you would place this new token and you would place it in a sea area. So it doesn't matter, you don't have to be right next to Braavos, you don't have to travel all that way over there. You can place this next to a boat that you have, and then when it gets revealed, and you would take it in turn order in terms of picking the loans, and you just take what's there and you pay for it, but you do it at the end of the round. Interestingly, this can only be played in the sea. If you see it has a blue background on it, the game also adds 2 extra sea tokens. So you've got a support token and a march -1 token that again can only be played at sea, but give you a few extra options. And these are added for all the factions. The other interesting thing about the Iron Bank is that if you take over Braavos, and you'll have to fight the garrison token that's there, you get a discount on future loans. It's only a 1 discount, so I don't think it's that great, but it's a little bit of a benefit for if you go and take over Braavos. One of my favorite things that they've added with this expansion is the ability to trade power tokens. You obviously get power tokens just like you would in the original game. They have your house on them, Now you can put one in the discard pile and take one out of the house that you're giving to, and they now get a power token. So really it's just like using it as a currency. And it adds so much more to the negotiation of the game. You can barter for stuff, because in the original game, maybe you weren't able to help that house, because if you're the Tyrells and you want the Starks to do something, there's nothing necessarily that you can offer them right now because you're nowhere near each other on the map. Whereas now you can just give them a token. Maybe it's because you want them to let you have the vassal house that you really need. Give them a couple of power tokens and that could be worth it for them. One of the most impressive things about this expansion is how much detail they've gone into with it. So they could have just ignored the previous expansion. So you've got Feast for Crows and Dance with Dragons that were little card expansions that really changed up the game that were out a few years ago. And they could have just ignored those. But no, they've made them both compatible with this game. You can play them and use the Fassal system. And so they've even given you a whole different deck of house cards to use with the Targaryens for the Dance with Dragons expansion, so that they play slightly differently and they fit the story, because Dance with Dragons is based much later in the series and all of the house cards change so that the factions play slightly differently. And they've done it with this. So whereas in the first deck, the Targaryens have some characters that are only in at the start of the series. Now they're introducing characters like Dario Naharis and Grey Worm into the story. Just from playing this expansion once, I'm really enamored with it. And everyone that I played the game with had played the original Game of Thrones before, and they all felt that what it added improved those little bits that were maybe considered problems with the original game and just added so much more thematic flavor. If you wanted to play the game with three or four players before and it just didn't quite work, I think now is your chance. You can actually have a decent game of it with three or four players. But if you love the original game and you want a different dynamic, a few extra additions, you want to be able to play it with seven or eight players, then absolutely. If you love this game, this is one of the most comprehensive expansions that I've ever played for any game. I'm so impressed by how much love they put into it, and I was surprised, to be honest. I can't wait to play this one again. The only downside with this game is just that it's a big commitment. It needs a massive table and it takes a while to play, but I think that it really delivers an epic experience that creates stories that you remember, and the expansion has only added to that. I've put a link to where you can buy this expansion in the description below. If you like this video, please subscribe to the channel to see more like it. I'm John Perkis. Thanks for watching.